Our next speaker is Steve Woodley. Steve's been at the firm longer than I have. He's been a partner his whole career at Gray River and Graham, and he's going to talk about ethical considerations in dealing with opposing counsel. Steve?
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. It's great to have all of you here today. My topic ethical considerations in dealing with opposing counsel at the court. And when you first read that, when I say it, it sounds like the focus is on making sure we're civil, ethical, with opposing counsel and the court. And that, of course, is true. But we cannot forget about the ethical obligation to our client. So when we talk about ethical considerations in dealing with the court, we're talking about opposing counsel court, being civil to opposing counsel, being honest with opposing counsel, and the same with the court. We are also talking about protecting as best we can, with as much effort as we can, the interests of our clients. And I would suggest to you, and hopefully have some ideas for you all today, that you can do both of those. You treat everybody civilly, ethically, truthfully, while enhancing as best you can the interests of your client. I would also suggest that taking that approach will make it easier to promote the interests of your client. And so what I'll do is, I'll have some suggestions about how to handle the court, how to deal with the court, and then we'll go over some of the rules. The same with opposing counsel. We'll talk about some suggestions, maybe a way to frame your thinking with opposing counsel, and then go over some of the rules that apply to how you interact with opposing counsel. You all are, for the most part, fairly young, fairly new attorneys. I'll also address a little bit how to deal with a difficult adversary, some ideas in that regard, and then perhaps some examples. So in dealing with the court, and Tom touched upon this a little bit, I think you need to take an approach that causes you to be professional, to be in a mindset where it's not a casual demeanor, it's a professional demeanor. And the things I'm going to tell you about are things that have worked for me. All right, I think they'd work for me. And I trained under Marcy Graham, I trained under Bob Ritter. I was two of the finest lawyers literally in the history of the state. I learned how to do things from them, and that's always been my mindset. But whether it's emotion practice, whether it's showing up for trial, whether it's showing up at the courthouse to talk about a trial date or just get a scheduling order, I think you need to take the same approach. When you walk into the courtroom, my approach, and I think a good approach, is your deference and respect for the court starts at that moment. As soon as you walk into that courtroom, that is the judge's courtroom. And for me, it sort of helps me settle down and focus on what I'm doing. I try to talk to all personnel in the court as if I'm talking to the judge. The bailiff is there, usually the clerk is there, sometimes the reporter. You communicate, you handle yourself with that person as if you're speaking to the judge. I personally do not like to talk. If you're on a motion, judges on the bench, hearing motions at the bench, a lot of lawyers in the courtroom. I have never, in that setting, been comfortable talking. It did not seem appropriate to me. And I think if you stick to what you're there for, listen to the judge, you'll see how he or she does things. You'll focus on your case in your mind, but I think that helps you frame how you're going to approach the court. Obviously, you must always be truthful with the court. And we'll talk about law and fact and those kind of issues. Even on somewhat side or maybe unimportant issues, you must be always truthful with the court. Sometimes you'll go up to the courthouse and someone will want a continuance. And the judge will say, well, why haven't we done this yet, or why haven't we done that yet? If it's because you just got behind, that's what you should say. Do not come up with some reason that isn't truthful. I remember a case I had in the city, long, long time ago. We went up there, the defense lawyer wanted more time, we were a little close to some deadlines. Judge said, why are we here, why aren't we ready? And I said, Judge, we had some issues scheduling, and we just truthfully got a little bit behind. I appeared in front of that judge for 2 years, that's how I used to work in the city. And he came to know me as a truth teller. I know that because he told me. And so when you then go back to that judge, and you've been honest all the way along, that has an impact on not how they're gonna rule, but if he's uncertain or she's uncertain about the case law, and there's two competing arguments, and they're both pretty good, you might get that call, not because it's doing a favor for you, but because that judge knows you as a truth teller. And I have never forgotten that. We argued a motion, the judge said, Steve, you're a truth teller, you win. And it was an important motion. So you must have that respect, that deference for the court, courtroom, its personnel, in my opinion, at all times. It's the right thing to do. It's the right thing to do for the right reason. It's required ethically, as we'll see. And I think it also will improve your likelihood of success. I also think it tends to allow you to be more careful in what you say, and more careful in what you do. And when you say something, you mean it. And we'll talk about some of these ethical violation cases. You'll see that in some instances, one decision at in front of the judge, not talking about a piece of evidence, or misrepresenting a piece of evidence, misrepresenting a fact, you're sanctioned. You cannot do that. And I think this approach keeps you more focused. So that's a general approach to the court that I think is a good one to keep in mind. Now, as far as the ethical rules, and all these rules are in your materials in full. I've tried to kind of pull out some of the more important parts. Rule 4-4.1, competence. When you file any plea, you are making a representation to the court that you are capable to handle that issue. And you'll see at the bottom, there is an ethical obligation to take and pursue those cases in which you have the legal knowledge, skill, thoroughness, and preparation reasonably necessary for the representation. As younger lawyers, newer lawyers, sometimes I think there's a pressure to maybe take on a case because you don't have a lot of cases. Someone assigns a case to you that you don't have experience in. You really shouldn't pursue those cases. You must be familiar with the issues in the case and be in a position to handle that case. So be careful with those cases you pursue. Rule 4-3.1, what you say in your initial pleadings and continuing throughout the representation must be meritorious claims and contentions. They must have a basis in law and fact that is not frivolous, which does include a good faith argument for an extension. So be careful with your statements. Be careful with your arguments. They must have a reasonable basis. These are the other rules. 4-3.3. Probably the issue that's gives rise to most problems for lawyers from an ethical standpoint and also with the court. A lawyer shall not knowingly make a false statement of fact or law to the court or fail to correct a false statement of material fact or law previously made. It's not just talking about a trial. It's not talking about in a final brief. It says, to the court at any time. You must be honest and straightforward with the court. Be very, very careful about that. Once you're not, the judge will never forget it. And you'll have that reputation for a long time. A lawyer shall not knowingly fail to disclose adverse authority. A lawyer shall not knowingly offer evidence the lawyer knows to be false. It's obvious, and we all know these things. But there are rules that say we have to do it. If you need a rule, you must do it. Do the right thing for the right reason. It will help you and help your client. Both the first part and the fourth part, I think, are sometimes overlooked. If you have answered an interrogatory, made a statement in a pleading, heard something at a deposition or something has been reported at a deposition, that you later learn is false, you cannot just act like it didn't happen. You have an ethical obligation to go back and correct. 4-3.5, it's a long rule. You all know about the ex parte communications. I just wanted to highlight that. You may see a judge at a party, you may see a judge at a bar function, you may see a judge at a softball game, at a baseball game. Do not talk about the case. That's just a simple rule. There are exceptions where you might need to communicate with the judge on a scheduling issue that comes up last minute. If you're going to do that, talk to the other side, send an email to the court, carbon copy or email copy to the other counsel. That is a very serious issue, ex parte communications. Don't think about doing it, don't do it. You may know the judge, you may have trained the judge. It doesn't make any difference. Do not talk to the judge about your file at any time other than with other counsel present. We were looking at the slides getting ready for today, and they said, well, why is that in there? I said, well, I kind of like this slide. And this is my father-in-law, a World War II veteran. He's 19 years old at the time, and he's in front of his plane. It was sort of impressive how big that engine is. And he went on to become a lawyer, had a very distinguished career, and was on the advisory committee for the ethics board in Missouri. I'm certain, never told a lie, was not straight with the judge, straight with the court. He's a very successful lawyer. And we could all probably write an essay about, let's talk about ethics based upon that picture. But I think there is a lot said in that picture. Plus, I like the picture. He was a really, really good guy. So we talked about the court. Now let's talk about opposing counsel. And I've got a pretty detailed, actually outlined in the materials, so that a lot of this is in there. But what I've always tried to do is, I think of the opposing counsel not as the enemy, right? Sometimes, particularly early on, it's an adversarial system. I'm against you, I'm gonna win, I'm gonna, whatever you say I'm worried about, and I don't like you, and yeah, right? All that may be true. It's not true. But that's not the approach. Right? But the other side, other counsel, whether it's an adjuster that you're dealing with, whether it's a representative of the company on the other side of an issue, whether it's a lawyer in a lawsuit, that lawyer, that adjuster, that representative of the company has the ability to resolve your client's issue. You, in that regard, have a common interest. And you don't want to do anything to detract from that. That lawyer on the other side can help get your case settled, or get your case resolved, or take it to trial. That doesn't mean you're going to give in to that lawyer. That doesn't mean you're going to trust that lawyer. That doesn't mean you're not going to work like crazy on the case. But what that lawyer or adjuster on the other side thinks of your case, and you want that person on the other side to think highly of your case, what they think of your case is going to, in large part, be based upon what they think of you. That you are the conduit for what they know about that case. And I came back, you know, I gave a talk one time about the jury of one. This really is your first juror. And so all the principles that apply to a jury trial, you should, as best you can, apply to interactions with that lawyer. What's the most important thing about a jury trial? You want to have what? Credibility, right? You want the jury to think you're credible. And they'll then believe what you have to say, believe your client's position. You want to do that, in my opinion, with the lawyer on the side of the case. You want to convey the best image of this case as possible. How do you establish credibility? You'll be prepared. You'll provide documentation. When you say you're going to do something, you're going to do it. When you say there's evidence to support this, you're going to supply it. That person is the one who may be in a position to resolve the issue that your client has. Additionally, if it's a lawyer that you're dealing with, which we're really focusing on here, you're going to see that lawyer down the road. And the next time you have the case with that person, she's going to know you're credible, you're honest, you're prepared. You kind of get to have the same jury of them. And this is not to say everybody's going to get everything worked out, but you want to present the best image of your case with that person. That's what you're hired to do. You're hired to get to the end, which is a satisfactory conclusion for your client. The person who can do that may be that other lawyer. Now, sometimes the other lawyer is not interested in doing it. And none of this detracts from your efforts on the case. Marcy Graham has never told a lie in his life. I am 100% certain of that, right, Marcy? And if he says no, it'd be the first one. And Marcy gets into a case and goes after every single detail, every piece of paper, every witness, and is after the case like nobody else. Bob Ritter was that way as well. One of the most civil persons in the world, Bob Ritter was the same way. Jerry Carmody, you're going to hear from, he's the same way. Nice guys, wonderful lawyers, wonderful people. That doesn't mean you're not going to work the case as hard as you can, as effectively as you can. You can do both. You can be civil while promoting the interests of your client. Do the right thing for the right reasons. You should be civil. You should be prepared. You should be nice. You should be civil to the lawyer. You will have positive benefits. You're not doing it just to get the positive benefits, but you'll have them. So that's the general approach that I think is to be considered. What are the rules say? 4-3.4, again, in the materials. These primarily deal with discovery issues, which as a younger new lawyer, you'll be dealing with a lot of discovery issues. Basically say you shall not obstruct another party's access to evidence, etc. You shall not falsify evidence. You shall not make frivolous discovery requests. And a lawyer must make reasonably diligent effort to comply with the legally proper discovery request. That's the ethical duty that you have to do. We all kind of know those things. But there's an ethical requirement to conduct yourself when you're dealing with opposing counsel regarding discovery. Again, do the right thing for the right reason. This is a continuation of 4-3.4. It actually extends those responsibilities to trial. At trial, counsel is required to limit their statements to what is relevant and supported by useful evidence. Now, there are also rules of evidence on that. But if the opposing counsel at trial gets up and starts an opening statement saying, here's what we're going to show, here's what the evidence is going to be, and you know if you work on the case, there's no such evidence. You have an obligation to object, get up there and not let him ever do it. There's also an ethical obligation to do it. You should not do it either. So all these rules apply to you. You should not do it either. You need to make sure your opponent doesn't do it. It applies to you. Make sure your opponent does the same thing. Counsel of the trial should not assert personal knowledge of facts at issue. If you walk down the courthouse, that probably happens almost every day. Know the law, right? Be prepared. Follow the ethical rules. Do the right thing for the right reason. It is inappropriate at trial to state a personal opinion as to the justness of a cause, the credibility of a witness, the culpability of a civil litigant, or the guilt or innocence of the accused. When I got back to the rules, I said, well, I'm not sure I knew that was there. I mean, it's an evidentiary issue. But that's how you are to conduct yourself at all times. Those rules we just talked about, if you think about it, they kind of apply to what lawyers do. How you handle discovery, how you respond to discovery, how you handle yourself at the courthouse and the courtroom with evidence. I had to go to the preamble to the rules to really find much about this idea of how should I deal with you? What is my obligation to deal with opposing counsel? And the paragraphs are numbered in materials. There's 15 or so paragraphs. But this was all I could find as far as real comment on dealing with others. As negotiator, which sometimes we are, the lawyer seeks a result advantageous to the client, but consistent with the requirements of honest dealings. So the preamble, not really a rule, But the preamble says we should be honest with others. A lawyer should demonstrate respect for the legal system and for those who serve it, judges, other lawyers, etc. So preamble in the ethics rule says respect for opposing counsel. A lawyer has an obligation to zealously protect and pursue a client's legitimate interest within the bounds of the law, which is that part of the equation we talked about. That's what we're doing while we're being civil. But you do that while maintaining a professional, courteous, and civil attitude to all persons involved in the legal system. So those are the guidelines. It really comes back to what you should do, how you should treat somebody else, how you will benefit if you treat the other lawyer that way. And it's also part of the ethical rules. Case law is in your, there's a page in your handout about that. And I put this up there, I didn't do an exhaustive research of these cases or all these issues. But as I'm looking at these cases, you look at the third one down. Generally, when an attorney with an intent to deceive the court submits a false document, makes a false statement, or withholds material information, doesn't say, you know, we're going to slap her on the wrist. Disbarment is the appropriate sanction. So those of you who aren't guided by principle, I'm sure we don't have anybody here, be careful. Because this is not, you know, this is not insignificant material. If you mislead the court with an intent to do so, you can be disbarred. The case, the Crico case cited at the bottom, that particular attorney had never been in front of the board before, had had no issues with the ethical board, no complaints, no sanctions, etc. Did the wrong thing in a hearing. It was a hearing for custody of a child. And it was really the first issue that the ethical board was aware of. And that lawyer was suspended for a period of time, even though that was the first time. And it gets back to this, you need to keep your focus at all times about telling the truth. Don't cheat the lawyer, don't cheat the judge with the evidence. Be focused and tell the truth. And there's consequences if you don't. Many of you may know that Alan Pratzel is the chief disciplinary counsel of the state of Missouri. So I called Alan a couple weeks ago and I said, you know, I'm gonna have an opportunity to visit with a lot of, you know, younger, newer lawyers, and if you could just summarize how to handle things. As I told him what the topic was, you know, dealing with opposing counsel, dealing with the court, what would you say? And I thought it was a great summary. These are his words. He said, I could quote them. Make sure representations in the pleadings and those made to the court are factually accurate. If you learn those representations are not accurate, go back and correct them. And Alan did say that seems to be a frequent issue is not going back, some things have changed, you go back and change the pleading. Be civil to the court and opposing counsel, be prepared. And he said, reports from the judges, keep in mind they're, of course, lawyers. They can file bar complaints. They can file, you know, those kind of problems or complaints. Reports from the judges show that, quote, being loose with the facts, end quote, and unprepared lead to the most bar complaints from judges. And he said, the mission is to protect the public and the integrity of the legal system, not to punish the attorney. And so do not think of the chief disciplinary counsel or his office as the sheriff who's trying to get people in trouble. Their office is extremely responsible. If you have a question about an ethical issue, what should I do, what should the other, is this appropriate or not appropriate, they're very easy to deal with in contact. Now, the conclusion I talked about, an overly adversarial opponent can and should be handled in a manner that maintains your professionalism, reputation, and protects and furthers the interests of your client regardless of the conduct of the opponent. Let me talk about that just for a few minutes. At your stage, maybe a little bit newer, a little bit younger, I think these issues are hard to get a hold of. And I think there are a lot of issues going on that make things more stressful. You're not certain what the other side should do or can do. you might be handling a case you're not familiar with, you've got a senior partner telling you to do something, you don't know the judges, you don't know the system as well, and so this uncertainty on top of the desire to win, right? Senior lawyer says, this is your motion, go win it. It's a lot of pressure. And so I think a lot of times earlier in the career, in careers, there can be the perception that the other side is being overly adversarial, or they're being unreasonable yielding. They object too much. They don't provide discovery responses. At depositions, they're belligerent. And there's a way to handle that. If you have those issues come up during written discovery, document the file. If responses are due and they're not in, send a letter. Document so that when you go up to the courthouse and have a motion to compel, you can say, here's what happened. We were promised these, we didn't get them, the answers are incomplete. That way the judge has a chance to make a ruling. At deposition, you may have somebody who is, you know, I mean, there are some people who practice different than other people. They're kind of obnoxious, they're adversarial, they're aggressive, and you're not sure what to do. First thing I would say is, try not to let them get to you. If somebody's making a big objection, and just don't be distracted by that. Don't listen to the objection. I mean, you have to listen to it, but don't necessarily respond to the objection. Stay focused on what you're doing, and then respond. Do not overreact. Do not engage in that behavior. If it's a person you know has a history of being difficult, consider videotaping the deposition. Most people on video will perform, will behave better than with no video. So there are ways to handle that. Also, if you have the opportunity, it's always good to talk to someone with more experience. A lot of you are experienced. But if you have an issue over discovery, somebody's seems to be unreasonable, talk it through with somebody with more experience. We're certainly always ready to have phone calls out there. Do not let the overly adversarial opponent interrupt with your pursuit of your case. You must not let your adversary distract you from developing the case and discovering relevant evidence. You must not let your adversary distract you from conducting yourself in a professional matter. You must always remain an officer of the court and conduct yourself accordingly. So, I've got a couple deposition clips, and I know many of you are experienced in depositions. Some of you are not, but I thought we'd go through just a few of them to give you some idea of how this actually plays out as a demo. These are all actual transcripts, with one exception, we've taken all the names out, but just to give a little perception of what can happen. This was a case I was actually, I just kind of gave it away. This case involved deposition of an expert witness. And this, I'm sorry, this was, that's the next one. This was a deposition of my client. Okay, ma'am, have you determined the dollar amount of damages that you're seeking from the pharmacy in this case? Attorney A, who was me, you don't need to answer that. B, are you going to instruct her not to answer? Absolutely. Do you think that's an appropriate question for a deposition? Do you really think that's an appropriate question for a deposition? Attorney B, yeah. Attorney A, jerk. You need to study it then. Attorney B, okay. Clearly inappropriate. I remember the deposition, kind of a nasty case. Now, I did later the deposition, page 97. While we have got a break here, I would like to apologize on the record to Mr. Attorney B. It's a long day, I'm sorry. I take no offense. And so I when that happened, I thought, well, maybe that'll be useful down the road for some educational something. And because you try to go into why is the person being unreasonable? Why do you think the other side is being disrespectful? Why are they being overly adversarial? And the first thing on the list, you always have to make sure, is to make sure it's not you. Because we can be that way ourselves. I was that way that day. And so then you think, well, why? That was a long, long time ago. I had two little kids. I was an older parent. We were very busy with the trial schedule. That's why I was a little bit of a jerk at the death. It was inappropriate. Luckily, I did think to respond to it, and he didn't file any kind of complaint. This was a deposition of a expert witness. And so we've got two pages here. We'll go through kind of quickly. But the deposition, this was an out-of-town deposition. It was a horrible case. My client had died, and it was an allegation that medical care was inappropriate, and because of the delay that the person died. And the lawyer who was asking the questions, I kind of knew. I was fairly new at the time. Had a little bit of a history of, you know, this behavior. So they're kind of getting into it, the whole deposition. And this is maybe after about an hour and a half. Questions, so you really have to listen to my questions. Don't anticipate, because generally when you do, it's not what I'm asking. And they've already kind of got this one. Okay, well, I apologize, at least I apologize. And what is the percentage of plaintiffs in this? Oh, I don't know. I would say, question, since you don't keep, and it's kind of delivered like this, since you don't keep records, it might be hard for you. Anything, and then the witness replies, anything else would be sarcastic, well, please do. The lawyer says, I will. So I'm sitting there thinking, all right, what am I going to do? And I was a fairly new lawyer. And witness says, pretty good response. I'm glad it's on the record, you're fine to read it, et cetera. Mr. Woodley, and I love my name here. I told you I was there before anyway. Object, come on, Mr. A. Do you want to? I can easily adjourn, we'll get permission. It's a little bit stilted. I mean, the language isn't great. And my point is, you still have to do it. I mean, you know, don't be afraid to remedy the situation. And so I say, I'll get a commissioner. Special masters probably the other clerk. And as you all probably know, if you're having a discovery issue with the other side, and you continue to have discovery issues with the other side, you go to the court and say, Judge, we're not getting along. We're having a lot of problems with discovery. And the judge will appoint either an experienced lawyer, sometimes a judge, usually a lawyer, who, if you've got a dispute, you'll go to that person. So, Attorney A, we have a difference of opinion on the ethics here. I don't think we need a commissioner. Well, it's not going to continue to be this kind of interrogation, and if you're going to, we're going to adjourn, we'll get a commissioner, et cetera. So again, the language a little stilted. You know, it was not completely smoothly handled by me, but I did the right thing. I said, I'm not going to put up with it. We're going to end the depo, and if we don't change things, we're going to go home. And the lawyer did change, and we did just fine. This one is long. I'll take you through it quickly. It has kind of an interesting ending. Long deposition. I've got a couple more questions. The doctors leave without my ability and our ability to finish up the examination. So it's an expert witness, and the doctor's trying to leave. Now, Attorney P at the bottom does the right thing. He makes, or she makes, a record. Right? When you're in a deposition, the words are taken down. You don't know if the person's screaming at you. You don't know if the person's shoving you. So the record is made. The deposition ended for two reasons. Number one, beyond the time, and the doctor has clearly demonstrated to everyone that he's leaving sharply at 3 o'clock. And secondly, I want the record to show that you are literally yelling at the doctor and arguing with the doctor. But no way to know that. It's hard not to imagine it because you're there. You're seeing it happen. But the words don't say it. That's why he did the right thing or she did the right thing at that point. Let me suggest, I'm not finished. That you're yelling to the doctor, again, documenting what was going on. At the bottom, you wasted all your time. You asked about two questions, et cetera. Now, doctor, are you leaving this deposition that has not been terminated yet? We are not done. Other attorney, that deposition was terminated. It's a little bit stilted, and the language isn't great. And my point is, you still have to do it. I mean, you know, don't be afraid to remedy the situation. And so I say, I'll get a commissioner. Special masters probably the better way. And as you all probably know, if you're having a discovery issue with the other side, and you continue to have discovery issues with the other side, you go to the court and say, Judge, we're not getting along. We're having a lot of problems with discovery. And the judge will appoint either an experienced lawyer, sometimes a judge, usually a lawyer, who, if you've got a dispute, you'll go to that person. So, Attorney A, we have a difference of opinion on the ethics here. I don't think we need a commissioner. Well, it's not going to continue with this kind of interrogation. If you're going to, adjourn, we'll get a commissioner. So again, the language is a little stilted. You know, it was not
completely smoothly handled by me, but I did the right thing. I said, I'm not going to put up with it. We're going to end the depot, and if we don't change things, we're going to go home. And the lawyer did change, and we did this one. This one is long. I'll take you through it quickly. It's kind of demanding. Long deposition. I've got a couple more questions. The doctor's leaving without my ability and our ability to finish up the examination. So it's an expert witness, and the doctor's trying to deal. Attorney P at the bottom does the right thing. He makes, or she makes, a record. Like, when you're in a deposition, the words are taken down. You don't know if the person's screaming at you. You don't know if the person's shoving you. So that the record is made. The deposition ended for two reasons. Number one, beyond the time, and the doctor has clearly demonstrated to everyone that he's leading sharply with his law. And secondly, I want the record to show that you are literally yelling at the doctor and arguing with the doctor. No way to know that. It's hard not to imagine it because you're there. You're seeing it happen. But the words don't say it. That's why he did the right thing or she did the right thing at that point. Let me suggest, I'm not finished. That you're yelling to the doctor, again, documenting what was going on. At the bottom, you wasted all your time. You asked about two questions, et cetera. Now, doctor, are you leaving this deposition that has not been terminated yet? We are not done. That deposition was terminated. Doctor, are you removing yourself from this deposition? Answer, this is the doctor. No, I'm removing you from my office. We should reenact this. We should do it. Okay, you're kicking us out. You're an expert in. Stop. You can't. I can throw you out of my office because you're an asshole. I'm out. Please leave my office. So the attorney is literally being wheeled out of the office by to her credit. Let the record reflect that the doctor is visibly turning my chair to dispose of the transcript. So if none of that is made, you would have no idea that was happening. So add a deposition. You know, make your record. Stop it if you have to. Because that stuff does happen. Now, the good news is St. Louis has a wonderful bar. 98% of your practice will be as it should be. Everybody's reasonable, courteous, respectful. If you're a newer, younger lawyer, my experience was the older lawyers kind of took you under the wing, even on the other side. They would do what they had to do to beat you, but they would be nice about it. Ethical issues, misleading the court, misleading the other side, very rare, very rare. So you're practicing in a wonderful community. And I wish you all the best luck in the future. And whatever cue you need, I need a cue once in a while to kind of stay on track. Do the right thing for the right reason. And everything kind of follows from that. So wish you the best.